which are very integral and vital of our community.
Thank you, Dan, and thank the organizers for going through that. In this talk, I'm going to discuss some recent work that I've done with Leonard Scott. He has a twisted history. His origins go back to our work on an unclued conjecture of development on a universal bound for one cohomology for finite groups. And we developed an approach to that for finite groups of Lucas by relating the cohomology of finite groups to the cohomology of quantum development algorithms of group units. And some of the stuff that came out of this was a possible attack on an old question from Janssen concerning peak operations of quantum models. And I hope to say at least what the theorem is at the end of the period if I have time. But in this talk, mostly I'm going to concentrate on some preliminary issues involving the existence of Kölkal gradients on finite dimensional quasi-literary algorithms associated with quantum groups. Characteristic zero and inclusive unities and algebraic groups and positive characteristics. And these include the Q-sure algorithms and classical Q-sure algorithms and characteristic P. Some of this was discussed a couple of years ago.
Get started. Some preliminaries. If I have a finite dimensional algorithm A, then we'll work with this category of finite dimensional A. And often A will be graded. And for me, that always means positively graded. I'm not interested in Z graded. And A Gur mod is the category of Z graded finite dimensional A modules. All of this notation is standard. If M is a graded module, then we can shift its grade. I steps to the right. That's M parentheses I down here at the bottom. And it's just the graded module defined this way, as a vector space is the same as M. And one useful fact is the category of graded modules has enough projectives so we can do homological algebra. So these are the groups here on the right, the graded X groups, and they're related to the ungraded X groups by this formula down at the bottom. Often, even though our algebra is graded, we'll consider the ungraded X groups. And it will also be convenient to assume that A has finite global dimension for the sorts of things I'm looking at. That's automatic. So many of these definitions, some of them can be made in more generally, but we won't need that. And we fixed a set, capital lambda, which indexes the simple A modules. So for lambda and capital lambda, L of lambda is a corresponding A module. And in case A is graded, we'll think of it. L of lambda is graded in degree zero. There are many definitions of what a Kölkal algebra is. The original paper is one of the original papers. It's often cited. It's Clitty's 1970 paper. And then the idea of Kölkal algebras were then picked up by work of Balanchine and Ginsburg, and later their work with Sergel on the category O in the late 80s and 90s. Anyways, this is one definition of Kölkal. A is Kölkal, so it's a positively graded algebra if for all lambda and mu indexing irreducibles and all integers I and j, if you have a graded Xn between L of lambda concentrated in degree I and L of mu concentrated in degree j, if that's not equal to zero, then I equals j minus I. I put down here as an exercise another definition of Kölkal, which maybe you'll like better. So you work in the bounded derived category and let proj be the full set category of finite complexes of graded projective modules where xi is generated by its term in grade minus I. And then A is Kölkal if and only if every simple object it's isomorphic to a complex one. It's pretty easy to see that that's the same as this up here. Okay, so that's the notion of closer. Now we're interested not only in our algebra being closer, but we want it to be quasi-algebra. So the last time I was in Korea, I think I gave a mini course on quasi-algebra. So you all remember that? Anyways, there's not much to remember. Lambda now is a partially ordered set. And there are certain families of modules called biomodules, which have L of lambda as their head. And all other composition factors are L of mu, where mu is less than lambda. And then there are projective covers for L of lambda, P of lambda. And these have a filtration where the sections are biomodules, with the top section delta of lambda, the biomodule corresponding to lambda, and lower sections, delta of mu, where mu gets bigger than lambda. So there's this kind of tension inside the biomodules, the weights go down, but in the filtration, the weights go up. And the typical example, or any standard example, is given here. If you have a semi-simple, simply connected group, over an algebraically closed field with a positive characteristic, and then take lambda to be a finite ideal, or saturated set of weights, I like to call them ideals, of dominant weights, then you can consider the, full subcategory, the category of rational finite dimensional G modules, which have composition factors L of lambda for lambda and capital lambda. And this is the module category for a quasi-hereditary algebra. That's the A equals A sub lambda here. And in fact, you can assume, you can cook up A so that it's a homomorphic image of the hyperalgebra or the distribution algebra G. And similar remarks apply to quantum developing algebras that use unity. And we'll make use of those algebras also. So these are... I was telling Dan I often have a problem with the clicker. I'm demonstrating that, huh? Anyways, these algebras A are sometimes called generalized Schur algebras. And... in the quantum case, they're called generalized Q-Schur algebras. Okay. And they're algebras that you want to know something about. Here's another concept that's important. If you have a finite dimensional algebra, remember I'm going to always assume it has finite global dimension. And take the direct sum of its irreducibles. That's M. And then we can form a finite dimensional algebra, A shriek, here. It's just the X algebra of M with itself. And the algebra product is just unit composition. And we call the, and it's finite dimensional because A has finite global dimension. And we call this the homological dual of the algebra A. Now, sometimes it's more convenient to do take something a little different from the homological dual. Instead of using M, we could just use A modulo the radical of A. And we get a slightly different algebra, slightly different X algebra. But it's pretty easy to see these two algebras are Eureka equivalent. Doesn't really matter. And one well-known result about causal algebras is that if A is causal, shriek algebra is also causal. And the double shriek, the X algebra of the X algebra, is Morita equivalent to A. Another homework problem. If A is causal, then the module category of the shriek algebra is equivalent to project. Remember that was complex, bounded complexes where X of I was generated by its term in gray I. Also not too hard to see. I think all these observations are probably due to Remerson and Ginsburg in one of their original papers on causal algebras. Okay, but the main thing to see on this page is the A shriek. And now we get to something that's a little more complicated. So suppose we have a length function on our weight post. Usually lambda, capital lambda, is indexed by elements in some affine vowel group. And then elements in the vowel group have a length because they're Coxeter groups. And so we can just take the length of the, use that as our length function. And there's a typo there. For lambda and I a non-negative integer, let's let delta upper I of lambda to be the ith radical of delta of lambda. And this definition will say that A satisfies the SKL prime condition, provided that for all lambda and mu and all integers, I and j, if you have an xn between the ith radical of lambda and an irreducible, then n is congruent to L of lambda minus L of mu plus I mod t. So it's a sort of parity condition enforced. There's also an SKL property. This stands for strong causalistic, which would replace L here by a dual of a Weyl module. And it implies this condition and doesn't seem to have any particular importance in what we're doing. One important thing, the special case when I equals zero up here, that's known as the causalistic condition, which CPS studied a long time ago, and it's in classical cases, its validity is usually equivalent to the validity of some kind of character formula for the irreducibles in terms of the Weyl modules. So that will be important later on. Anyways, we defined this SKL property a long time ago. And as I say here, with one exception, which will come up in a minute, it's lived a life of quiet obscurity. And the quiet life of obscurity ever since. And as far as I know, only a few people have ever used it. Anyways, it's a strange homological condition. Here are some examples. Well, kind of like the first one. It's the Schur algebra, S33 and characteristic 3. So a week or so ago, there was a meeting in Raleigh, the Southeast Leap Theory Conference. And we have workshops for graduate students. And Dan Nakano presented part of this because he worked out part of this example for the students. At least everything on this page. So the algebra, the Schur algebra, you take a vector space of dimension 3 and you make the symmetric group on three letters act on the right by permuting around the factors. And then you take the centralizer ring of that, and that's S33. Its irreducibles are indexed by partitions of 3, and so there are 3 of them. And you can easily, and we're in characteristic 3, so this is related to the representation of GL3 in characteristic 3. So you can easily describe the Weyl modules here. A means the irreducible corresponding to this partition, and that's an irreducible module of dimension 2, I think. And then here's the Weyl module for B. Here's the one for C is irreducible. We order these by the dominance order, so this is the biggest, this is the second biggest, and the next one. And the projectives are also easy to figure out. P of A's projective cover of A is the Weyl module. Projective cover of B is this thing. And with C, it's a uniserial module. And we can assign these things lengths. We'll just make A and C even and B odd. It's just the parity that's important. And this algebra has a single block. And anyways, using this information, it's easy to work out resolutions of delta I of X. I did that here. And then in the table, I computed these X groups here. For example, if you let delta x star of delta 1, so that's a radical of delta of A with L of B, that here. So it's the field in character in degree zero, and it's the field in degree two, and that's it. Anyways, it's got the right part of it. So you can see,
probably best to do this yourself,
that this algebra satisfies the SKL condition. Okay, so that's just a, an amusing exercise. And then homework three is check this. I guess I'm getting ahead of myself with this. It'll turn out that anything that satisfies the SKL prime condition is cosine. And associated graded algebra is cosine. Let's just wait on that. Anyways, it's easy to, if I've done this correctly, it's easy to write down this as equivalent relations. And actually you see that the algebra A itself is cosine. And this is nice. Its shriek is 14 dimensional. And it follows that A and A shriek, well, are not Morita equivalent.
So this is, I guess that's not entirely obvious, but I've checked it.
So this is not like the category O, where you take the dual of the O trib and get O trib back again. You get something different. Let's see, if you try this for S35 in characteristic 2, I think the SKL prime condition fails. And there's another, John Carlson has worked out lots of stuff on his webpage. I'm sure if you look at this, you'll see that it doesn't work in that case. And this is the only known, these are the only known three people that I know of who've actually used SKL prime before this talk. And they checked it for the category O for the real store. You can understand about that. You could ask whether SKL prime does not imply cosine.
Right?
Yes.
In the case of the category of field, in that case, as the usual field condition is cosine?
No.
Only in the field, not here.
SKL is stronger than SKL.
Yeah, but as a field, so.
I don't think so.
Well,
that is. Oh, KL. I'm not sure. I didn't check it. You might.
Well, we love to see an example.
It'd be easier. It's probably contained in there. Okay. In fact, I think it probably does.
No, not in here. This example calculation two.
No, this is three.
No, no. You're talking about the one.
Oh, you're. Yeah, okay.
All right. John,
I don't know. Okay, she won't get checking.
Well, I want to rerun the exercise, so we should actually put this in automatically.
I agree.
Yeah.
Anyway, SKL prime does not imply causal, and this is too complicated to really talk about, but here's an example of a quiver with relations that, which is SKL prime, but it is not causal. So let me just... Okay, so now I want to talk about some new results. And again, we have this finite dimensional algebra. Most of the time it's a finite global dimension. And Gure is this radical, the algebra you obtain from this radical series. And it's a positively graded algebra. Sometimes A is graded itself and is isomorphic to Gure, and then you say that A is tightly graded. And there's certainly a functor from A modules to Gure modules, taking M to Gure M, defined this way. This isn't a very good functor. It preserves surjections, but otherwise it's not even left exact. On the other hand, you can do something. And as Leonard said in his, Leonard Scott talked on this, well, and as he said, we ended up writing a kind of treatise on this functor. But if you start with a short exact sequence of modules, you apply the Gure functor here and here, and then you just define this thing to be the kernel of that map. And so you get another short exact sequence. And it's pretty easy to figure out what this Gure pound L is. That's just given by this term in grade S, is you just intersect L with Brad S of M and factor of L intersected with Brad S plus 1 of M. And so that's a graded Gray module. Okay. So I'd like to relate X one between A and Gray. There's a missing one right here. And just as an illustration of the idea. So suppose you start with a projective cover of M. That's this thing. And you form the associated grading thing. Okay. And that's still going to be a projective cover of Gura. And now suppose you have a completely reducible module, L. And you're trying to compute X1 between M and L. So on the right-hand side, you have, it's just going to be HOM of omega, here's omega, mod the radical of omega into L. And on the left-hand side, we've got this thing homing this into L. And this module maps surjectively onto Gur pound of omega mod rad omega. It's pretty easy to see. But this is now completely reducible. And there's some kind of isomorphism between this thing and itself, between Gur sharp of this and this module. This is true whenever you have a completely reducible module and you form Gur sharp of it, you don't lose anything. It just sort of takes its simple sum ends and tweaks the grades up. So you get a diagram like this, and that gives you, when L is completely reducible, you at least get a map, in fact, as a containment of X1 of ML into X1 of Gur A Gur ML. So this is the ungraded X. L is completely reducible. It's a very special case. Now, this is what I wanted to state, is this theorem. And this is sort of an indication of how we are attacking our problem. We have this algebra capital A, and inside of it there's a tightly graded subalgebra with the property that the radical of this subalgebra generates the radical of the whole algebra. And suppose we have a module M such that when we restrict it to this subalgebra, it becomes graded and is generated by its term in grade zero. And there are a couple more hypotheses here. M has a projective cover. It is a big A module, which is projected as a little a module. And the next one is not too serious. There's a Wedderburn complement for capital A containing little a zero. And M zero is big A zero stable. So there's some conditions here. But anyways, then you get an isomorphism from X1 AML into X1 Gur A Gur ML. And the neat thing about this is the algebra little a is now faded into the woodwork and you don't see it anymore. It somehow, its presence is enough to control to give you an isomorphism from here to here. Okay, so the situations we're going to be in involving, say, Q-sure algebras, is we're always going to have this algebra A. And it's actually going to be rather special. It's going to have better properties than just being tightly graded. Okay. So its presence somehow controls the behavior of capital A. Okay, so the next couple slides are just, it would be nice just to skip over them because they're just a list of conditions that are required. A is quasi-hereditary over the field. You've got this tightly graded subalgebra. And also, because we're eventually going to bring in quantum groups, there are a couple Hopf algebras around which map onto little a and big A. And this turns out to be a kind of technical condition which is easily satisfied for us, but it's useful to have. Again, we make this condition that the no radical of A generates, of little a generates the radical of big A, and 5 is too serious. We fix a Wedderburn complement of capital A containing the one, the, this will be the Wedderburn complement of little a. And we assume they're both separable algebras over, this should be over the field F, or this should maybe be capital K, and this is capital K. So we have these conditions. And well, the first theorem says that suppose you have a weight little lambda, such that the projective cover of the Weyl module is projective for this little algebra, little a, then you can recursively construct a grading, a little a grading of the Weyl module, which is generated in degree zero, and such that the zero part is stable under the Wedderburn complement. Okay, so we have this subalgebra, and we're using it to grade Weyl modules, is the idea. And the condition that delta be A projective will be very easy for us to satisfy in our case, because we can always go to a bigger ideal in our set of dominant weights, so we pick up the entire PIM for the restricted developing one. So that's what this next hypothesis is really telling us, that we're assuming that you can enlarge A in order to force the these PIMs for deltas to be projective for little a. Okay, so yeah, I think you can pretty much forget that hypothesis. I mean, okay, so here's the two theorems, the theorem and a corollary. Now we want to assume little a is a Kozel gradient. So that's a strong assumption. And want to assume that capital A has a satisfies the Kozdan-Lustig condition with respect to the length function. So this was the I equals zero case of this SKL condition. And then that's enough to show that A satisfies the SKL condition with respect to L. Okay. So if you have this kind of situation, and if all the hypotheses above are satisfied, then you can prove this condition. Well, I haven't said yet what this condition is good for, and I've summarized some of the consequences of it in the corollary. First of all, Gurov A is graded quasi-hereditary, so it's pretty strong, and its Weyl modules are just the grades of the Weyl modules for A. Gurov satisfies what we call a graded Kozdan-Lustig condition, but what that means is that Gurov is Kozel. And Gurov and A have the same Kozdan-Lustig polynomials, which I haven't defined, but you can imagine what they are. They're the same Kozdan-Lustig polynomials for affine Weyl groups if we're in that situation. And then the next thing is something I really like, A Shriek. That's isomorphic to Gurov Shriek. And that's also Kozel, and it's also quasi-hereditary. And its Kozdan-Lustig polynomials are also known. They're the inverse Kozdan-Lustig polynomials here. So once we have this condition up here, the corollary follows from stuff we did back in 1994. So I'd like to just talk about some applications of this to more concrete situations. And so, take a quantum enveloping algebra at an eighth root of unity. Dan was talking about in his talk. Associated to an irreducible root system. Assume that E is bigger than H, and probably that E is not the relatively prime to any bad prime of the root system. And let X plus of E reg be the postset of E regular dominant weights. And so we just partially order X plus in the usual way, one weight's bigger than another if the difference is a sum of positive roots. Or we can use Janssen's up arrow partial ordering as we want. And then for a finite ideal of regular weights, we get one of these quasi-hereditary algebras whose module category identifies with the category of type 1 integral U sub zeta modules, which have composition factors lying entirely in this finite ideal. And we can arrange it so that A is a homomorphic image of U zeta, and A is one of, generalized Q-sure algebra. It's not quite a Q-sure algebra in type A, but it's not hard to go from this to the Q-sure algebra setting. Now the dominant weights are indexed, or dominant alcoves are indexed by the set of distinguished right coset representatives of W of max in the affine bar group of maximal right. And then we use that to define a length function on gamma. Okay. Now, as has been mentioned in the previous talk, the Lustig character formula holds for U zeta. Then A satisfies the Kajtan-Lustig property. And then this last sentence is pretty important. Assuming that the Lustig character formula holds and it's in the Ossmann circle, have proved that, they proved that a regular block in the little quantum group is causal. And so they have kindly provided us with this causal algebra, little a. We just take it to be the image of the little quantum group in A, and that's going to be an isomorphism on the blocks, provided we take gamma to be big enough. So we do that. So we're all set up to apply the theorems from the previous section. And here it is. It's nothing more than just a restatement. The category Gure of great, the category of graded modules for Gure is a graded highest weight category, weight plus the lambda. In particular, Gure is quasi-hereditary and it's causal. And for lambda and gamma, the associated Weyl module is just the graded version of the Weyl module for the quantum loop. And then let's just recall that the inverse Kajtan-Lustig polynomials associated to the Kajtan-Lustig polynomials of Gure are defined recursively in the usual way here. And once we have those, we can state this corollary. The homological dual A shriek is a graded quasi-hereditary algebra. I should have also, in particular, that means that it's causal. This last condition is kind of interesting. These inverse Kajtan-Lustig polynomials calculate the graded multiplicities in the sections of the Weyl models. Okay, I don't know if that was known before. Although there is a paper of a week recently that has a similar result, but it's different. Okay. So you can look at the there's something missing here. Oh, wait a minute. So we look at the multiplicities of this graded piece and this graded module that's given by this polynomial. Okay, let me try to summarize this or restate it. So take a weight lambda minus in the negative fundamental alcove of this affine bar group W. I think this is exactly what Dan was talking about this morning. And let WE plus be the distinguished right coset representatives of the Weyl group in WE of maximal length. And for W and WE plus, let's let lambda equals W dot lambda minus. It's W of lambda minus plus rho minus rho be the regular corresponding regular weight, and we'll identify lambda with W and write W of lambda in place of this notation. And then we form this huge algebra. It's the X algebra of direct sum over all X and Y in W and E plus of the X between L of X and L of Y. Well, this is an algebra without an identity. Because there are infinitely many weights that we're adding up. However, if we take a element, a distinguished coset representative, and let one sub X be the identity map regarded as an element in here, then we can form these idempotents. We just sum up all the one sub X's for the length of S, X at most n. And what we see is this algebra here, which is the centralizer ring of corresponding to the idempotent E sub n, is this X algebra for this finite dimensional sum of irreducibles. And it's the homological dual of one of these generalized Schur algebras from the previous slide. So, and these algebras are all Kozal and quasi-arbitrary. They're all Kozal and quasi-arbitrary. So how can you use this? Well, I'll mention a couple, or one possible application that has to do with a possible complexity theory for the big quantities. So elsewhere, in a different problem, we've proved the following. If you take a dominant weight lambda and you sum up all the dimensions of the, and you fix an integer n, x, n, l, zeta of lambda with l, zeta of mu, over all dominant weights mu, this number is actually bounded. There's a constant which bounds it for all lambdas. I guess it isn't even, maybe not too hard to see, but maybe it isn't even immediately clear that this is a finite number. But it is. And this universe is bounded. Now, we'd like to know something about what this bound is, but we know that our X algebra is total, so it's generated by the stuff in degree one. So if we fix X, we can bound this sum by this kind of sum, where these mu's are the leading coefficients of certain Kazan-Lussi polynomials, which calculate X ones. And this sum itself is bounded. Pretty amazing, actually. So this suggests one combinatorial question. For X in a distinguished coset representative, we'll let R sub phi be the maximum, this maximum here. So it's the maximum over all X, a distinguished coset representative of this sum. And this is a bounded integer. What is it? And of course, if we feed this back into the previous page, we see that at least this number here is exponential growth given by this. But while the bound is exponential, if you drop the sum over nu, it's got polynomial growth. And in other words, we have a condition like this. Well, this is some constant depending on the root system. Okay. So there's some kind of a complexity for the big quantum group, not just the little bit, which is related to support variety theory from the previous talk. Let's see, how does all this work in positive characteristics? Well, let's recall the Janssen region. It's the set of all dominant weights such that lambda plus rho, alpha naught check, alpha naught is the maximum short root, is less than or equal to p times p minus h plus 2. And suppose you take an ideal of dominant weights, which is, consider the ideal of dominant weights generated by the p-restricted dominant weight. So look at all dominant weights that are less than or equal to some restricted weight. And then this theorem says the previous results also work for capital C. As long as you assume P is bigger than or equal to 5H minus 5, and the Lustig character formula holds on for the Janssen region. In other words, Lustig's conjecture is valid. Judas, as Dan mentioned, in many cases. So in particular, if you represent the this category of all regular weights by quasi-hereditary algebra, its graded version is quasi-hereditary again and is causal. Now, one way to think about this is the Janssen region has a very key point to it, which is down at the bottom here. If you take a weight in the Janssen region and you write it as a restricted weight plus p times another dominant weight, then this lambda 1 lies in the bottom p alcove. So it's just like in the quantum case, when you're looking at the irreducibles, which are the where their high weights are coming out of the bottom p alcove, it's the semi-simple category. So it's exactly like what Dan was talking about, where the quantum enveloping algebra modulo the little quantum group was the universal enveloping algebra of the complex U element. It's completely reducible. Exactly the same situation happens here. And that's the whole point of the Janssen region, it seems to me. And that's what makes this theorem true. Okay, it sort of forces all of the conditions that I wrote down, which we've all forgotten, to be satisfied. In the last couple of minutes, let me say something about filtrations. So this is a problem that Leonard and I worked on for a long time. And so let G be a simple, simply connected algebraic group over an algebraic equals field of positive characteristic. And in 1980, Janssen considered the following question. Given a dominant weight, does the biomodule delta of lambda have a filtration whose sections are of this form here? Pardon?
The gate technically has 2 power or supposed to be 1 tau zero?
Should be tau zero. L of tau zero, that's L of a restricted weight, tensored with the twist of another biomodule. Saying it's full of tau zero. Okay, does it have such a filtration? And nowadays people call such a filtration delta P filtration. Now Janssen, in his paper, he proved this when lambda is far from the walls. And he also established it, and actually did quite a bit of work. It's really non-trivial for SL3. Let's see, if you were at Misery last year, you heard Anderson talk on this one. In particular, it's implied by another conjecture that's still unproved due to Dalton, that a module has a delta P filtration if and only if, when you tensor it with Steinberg, it has a delta P filtration. That would easily prove this result. So what we have are the following two theorems. Assume P is big enough. What we think now that means, we're pretty certain, we haven't written the proof of this theorem down completely, is that just means that P has to be big enough so the Lustig character formula is true, and maybe also bigger than or equal to 2H minus 2 so that PIMs have a G-module structure. Then for any regular weight, if you look at the biomodule delta of lambda, and you look at the ith radical section for the infinitesimal subgroup G1, okay, these are actual G modules. That has a delta P filtration. And we think we can prove that. I'm pretty certain of it. And now if you translate to the walls, you get it in general. Except you lose this condition here. We don't know quite how when the translation to the walls would probably may not preserve the radical sections, but at least it preserves the delta P filtration. So this, if the love of someone proved the lusty conjecture tomorrow, proved it, repeat bigger than the wrinkled edge, this would certainly solve that question. At least in that case. Lost.
Kurt, is the conjecture though for all p?
The conjecture is for all p. I seem to have lost my last slide, but I can say what I want to say. One thing is if how do quantum groups apparently arise in this P conjecture here? And it has to do with the fact that if, say, the Lustig conjecture is true on the Janssen region, and if you take an irreducible module and for the quantum enveloping algebra, and you just follow the procedure in Steinberg's notes and pick a minimum lattice and reduce it mod p, then this is the module you get. So philosophically, you could think of this problem as an attempt to reconcile the quantum version of the Steinberg tensor product theorem with a characteristic P Steinberg tensor product theorem. And the fact that Weyl modules for the quantum group reduce the Weyl modules for the algebraic group. Now you can ask the same sort of question earlier about this. You can consider the same point of view earlier for the Kozal algebras. And also for this stuff on that Dan talked about for support products. And you see this very close parallel between the quantum enveloping algebra and characteristic P as long as the Lustig character formula holds. This one is very similar, but it's somewhat more subtle. But it still kind of fits that pattern of sort of bringing the two Steinberg tensor product theorems in alignment with one another. And that's a good place to stop.